So good afternoon to everyone. It's always a pleasure for me to be here. This is my fourth time in the DNSG symposium, and it's a pleasure for me to share with all of you these days and here in Opatia. So on this occasion, I'm going to talk about NADs in the prevention of type 2 diabetes and microvascular complications. So as you know, and it was shown before by Professor Darío in that 4 hours length opening ceremony, so the incidence of type 2 diabetes is increasing worldwide, as it is shown in this in the last data of the IDF Atlas. So currently, more than 400 people has diabetes, but is expected to rise up to 600 million people, sorry, not 600, 600 million people in 2045. So I think it's also important to highlight that as many as one-third to one-half of diabetes cases remains undiagnosed for several years, for many years, but they are at risk, or they are already at risk of cardiovascular or cardiometabolic disorders. So we also know that type 2 diabetes compromise our health, and we know that there are some complications associated to type 2 diabetes. We saw before as well. Some of these complications are cardiovascular disorders, but there are also microvascular complications. So we are talking about nephropathy and retinopathy, basically. So the chance to develop type 2 diabetes is a combination of risk factors. Some of these risk factors are unmodifiable, maybe genetics or age within others, but some of them are modifiable risk factors. So, for example, diet or physical activity. So we can change our diet, we can change our physical activity, our activity. So looking at diet, this is my topic today. Looking at diet, it's quite consistently across the studies that Mediterranean diet reduce the risk for type 2 diabetes. And if we look at the Mediterranean pyramid, we can identify here NADs. So the point is that this key food of the Mediterranean diet can play an important role in the management and the prevention of type 2 diabetes, and probably, why not, in the microvascular complications associated to type 2 diabetes. So, however, despite the clear evidence regarding the beneficial properties of NAD consumption on cardiovascular disease, there is a lack of consensus about what really happened, what's the relationship between NADs and type 2 diabetes. So results of large cohort studies demonstrate some of them a negative association, but others couldn't find any significant relationship. So, taking into account some meta-analyses that were published in American Journal of Clinical Nutrition in 2014, we can see that whereas some of these meta-analyses couldn't find any relationship between NAD consumption and the risk of type 2 diabetes, like this one or the other one, there is the third one reporting a negative association between NAD consumption and the risk of type 2 diabetes. So once again, there is no consensus in the literature about the relationship, the real relation between NADs and type 2 diabetes. Later on, a study conducted in the EPIC cohort, again, didn't find any significant relationship. There was a negative trend, but was not significant. Any significant relationship between NAD consumption, in this case were nuts and seeds, and the risk of type 2 diabetes. The same results were later on in this meta-analysis of prospective studies that they also found a negative association, but was not significant. But even though the results of epidemiological studies do not support a beneficial role, or at least consistently, between NAD consumption and type 2 diabetes, clinical trials are not telling us the same. So just to summarize, I would like to show you these results that you really know probably better than me, because they were conducted in the group of John Sieben Piper. So they conduct a meta-analysis based on randomized clinical trials in order to analyze the association between NAD consumption and glucose and insulin metabolism. So they report an inverse association between NAD consumption and glycated hemoglobin, so improving the control of type 2 diabetes, also with the levels of glucose, but they didn't find any association with HOMA insulin resistant and fasting insulin. So it means, or it seems that we can modify glucose, but maybe not insulin or HOMA insulin resistance. But what about NADs and microvascular complications of type 2 diabetes? So it's if it's difficult to determine the effect or the potential role of NADs on type 2 diabetes, it's even more difficult to determine this association or this relationship with microvascular complications, because there is almost nothing published on that. So do you really believe that NADs can play a beneficial role on these microvascular complications or not? So probably the answer would be yes, if we consider that microvascular complications also respond to inflammatory and oxidative stress, and also if we remember that NADS has been associated with anti-inflammatory and antioxidant antioxidant properties. So if we think that with these two different bases, we can say yes, probably. Probably microvascular complications can be improved, the risk of microvascular complications can be decreased if we eat NADs regularly. But we do not have enough literature on that. So I was trying to find some studies based on this point, and it was really, I did not succeed at all. But anyway, I would like to show you these results. Are not based on what NADs are doing in our health, but it's, I think, it reflects perfectly that in case of nephropathy, oxidative processes and inflammatory processes play a role. So this is a meta-analysis that was conducted on randomized clinical trials that were assessing the role of antioxidant treatment, the effect of antioxidant treatment on some condition related with nephropathy. So, for example, in this case, I show you what happened in the meta-analysis, what was the effect of antioxidants on changes on glomerular filtration rate. And as you can see here, they found a significant, they found an improvement in these metabolic parameters. So antioxidant treatment improved the rate of glomerular filtration, but they failed to find any significant effect on changes in serum creatinine and changes in creatinine to albumin ratio. Okay, if we move to microalbuminuria, I show you here the results of a cross-sectional analysis conducted in the MESA study, in the multi-ethnic study of atherosclerosis, over more than 5,000 participants. As you can see, they divided the population according to quintiles of NADs, and they couldn't find any significant association between NAD consumption and microalbuminuria. So, time ago, we ran an analysis in the context of the PREDIMED trial. I'm not going to explain again what the PREDIMED is, because Penny explained it perfectly a few minutes ago. So, in this case, we checked the effect of low-fat diet, Mediterranean diet supplemented with olive oil, and Mediterranean diet supplemented with NADs on the risk of for suffering retinopathy and nephropathy. So, in this case, we select those patients who had type 2 diabetes at baseline, so they were 3,614. And during a median of follow-up of 6 years, we identified 74 new cases of retinopathy and 168 new cases of nephropathy. So as you can see in the table and also in the curve, we reported a decreased risk of for retinopathy in case of subjects allocated in the Mediterranean diet supplemented with olive oil group. No associations were found, or no effect, well, associations were found in case of nephropathy, and no associations in case of those subjects allocated in the Mediterranean diet plus a NADS group. But we have reanalyzed again this data, in this occasion, dividing the population according to the NAD consumption. So we divided the population in three different groups: those who ate less than one serving per week of NADs, those who ate between 1 serving per week to 3 servings per week, and those who ate more than 3 servings per week. In this slide, I show you the association with the risk of nephropathy. And you can see here in the, well, in all the models, but also in the fully adjusted model, we found a significant reduction for the risk of nephropathy in those participants who ate the higher amount of nuts. We did the same analysis, but in case of raffinopathy, and in this case, we couldn't find any association with a lower or a higher risk of raffinopathy. And we also run a similar analysis, but in this case, based on cataracts. I know cataracts are not considered as a microvascular complication of type 2 diabetes, but we also know that cataracts or patients with type 2 diabetes has a higher risk for suffering cataracts with the time. So in this case, we divided again in the same categories, participants in less than 1 serving per week from 1 to 3 and more than 3 servings per week of nuts, and once again you can see here that we found a significant reduction of the risk of cataracts in those consuming a higher amount of nuts. So we conclude that seems to be something there, but maybe we need to explore in a deep way. And I don't want to leave you today without showing, at least in my opinion, a temptress hypothesis on how telomere length or telomerase activity can contribute to these microvascular complications. You know that telomere length and telomerase activity is related with aging, but it's also related with cardiovascular disease and with type 2 diabetes. So in our group, we are interested in this enzyme and these molecules. And I was looking for something in the literature regarding telomere length and microvascular complications of type 2 diabetes. So I would like to show in your left this study published in 2009, so it's not new at all. And the author described that the proportion of short telomeres was an independent predictor for the risk of nephropathy, diabetic nephropathy. So it suggests that telomere length can play an important role there. And when we look at what's happened with the telomere length in patients with diabetic retinopathy, this is a cross-sectional analysis to determine if there is any association between the telomere length with the presence and the severity of this microvascular complication. We can see, well, I'm not sure if we can see anything there, but anyway, these are the control group. These are non-diabetic retinopathy. These are patients with non-progressive diabetic retinopathy, and these are patients with progressive diabetic retinopathy. So in any case, what they found was a significant reduction in the telomere length in those participants who had retinopathy, and especially in those participants who had diabetic retinopathy. So now the question is whether the intake of nuts, so if we agree that maybe telomere can play, or telomere length can play a role in the progression or the establishment of this type 2 diabetes complications, now the second question could be, can nuts provide any help based on a modification of this telomere length or telomerase activity? So can nuts reduce the telomere shortening as a potential mechanism reducing the risk of diabetes microvascular complications? So I will invite you all, so you will find the answer next Friday in this symposium, in the presentation of my colleague Silvia Canuda. So this is a short oral abstract where she will present the preliminary results we have in a study we conduct with pistachio. This type of nuts in the telomerase activity, and now we are running the telomere length. So thank you very much for your attention.